Hello and welcome to Go East Film Festival of Central and Eastern European Films. My name is Dominik Streib and I am doing the program coordination of the festival. Here with me in our studio is the director of the film Froth, Ilya Powolotsky. Hello. And Victoria, she will do the translation in Russian. So welcome you both, and fine that you're here in these strange times where Q&As have to be via Zoom. But for sure, thanks, Ilya, for this very insightful documentary in everyday life in this little village at the Barents Sea. It's really an astonishing film with very wonderful images and also these stories of the few people which are kind of left there and didn't leave the town. So maybe you can tell me a bit more, because the images are so beautiful. What was the intention to make the film? Was there first the region to catch the beauty of the region? Or were there the stories of the protagonists? So what was at the beginning of the film?
Герой, конечно. Я услышал, путешествуя по северу, об одиноком старике, таком морском волке, живущем в заброшенном поселке, и, собственно, набравшись храбрости, нанял лодку и пришел в этот поселок сначала в одиночку. Вот, собственно, познакомился, он действительно существовал, это не было легендой. А потом и родилась идея картины в целом.
Of course, it was the characters. In fact, when I was traveling by sea, I heard about this old man who lives in a tiny village, a sort of a lone wolf. And I kind of gathered my courage and just walked into the village. I hired a boat and traveled there and walked into the village first alone and made an acquaintance. And this person was real. It wasn't a legend. And that was the main encounter. And then came the idea of the film.
I think the guy you talk about is Bardak, or the real loner there. And I liked also the your sales agent Antipode has this little claim, Sapolo cowboys, and I think really this term is really fitting to the protagonists of this film, and also Bardak is I think one of the most interesting protagonists of the film, because you see him and you think what he's doing is some kind of pointless or something. You didn't really catch what he's doing or for what he is doing that. And also Dima once said that Bardak is the major of himself or the president of himself. I really like that. And maybe you can tell us a bit more about this character, because it, as an audience, you really like the pictures and what he's doing, but you really can't catch because he's a real loner. So what he's really doing?
No, во-первых, начнем с метафизики. В его финальном портрете, когда мы оставляем его на фоне этих руин, лично для меня становится очевидным какая-то его немного нечеловеческая сущность с этими двумя разными глазами, потому что у него один глаз отсутствует и вставлен искусственный хрусталик. И они разного цвета. Помните, как история с Тором, который лишился глаза. Вот. Но давай, наверное, короткими буду, да, чтобы...
Let's start with metaphysics. In the shot where we sort of leave him on the background of this abandoned place, it had a strong sense of his almost supernatural character, and also very symbolic that he has an artificial eye, and his eyes are of different color, and it reminds me of Thor, who has lost one eye, and for me this was a real crystal moment right there.
Потом важно же понимать, что ничего такого он там и не делает, в принципе. Он просто он там живет один. Когда весь этот поселок все покинули, он, прослуживший там 28 лет, решил остаться. Но, тем не менее, совершенно очевидным становится, что жизнь вокруг, тем не менее, вокруг него и этого места вращается. И поэтому, если коротко, то он, наверное, хранитель вот этого места.
It's also important to understand that he's not really doing anything. like you say, it's pointless what he's doing. He's just living there. He's served there for 28 years and decided to stay. And he just keeps on living there, and somehow the life around him is gravitating, sort of centered around him and gravitating towards him. And it seems to me that he's a sort of a caretaker of the place, a guard of a sort.
Like a superhero, as you said. Yeah, I really like this description. And also now, maybe coming back from the metaphysics to more based themes, maybe to Dima, which is also a character I really like because he's a poacher and he's crossing the laws all the time. But on the other hand, he's such a lovely guy who's treating his children in a really wonderful manner. And I also like the scene with the German tourists, because he just wants to help, and the Germans were, oh God, he's got a knife and so. And as a German, I really imagine German tourists like this. And that was kind of funny. Maybe you can also talk a little about Dima and how is he living. And he's a poacher, but on the other hand, such a really nice and warm guy.
Ну, Дима вообще невероятная для меня находка, и это тот герой, к которому лично я эмоционально подключаюсь больше всех. Я по-хорошему в него влюблен, был с самого начала. И мы как довольно при необычных обстоятельствах познакомились, формата Q&A не хватит про это рассказать. Но я сразу подумал, черт возьми, этот парень живет одним днем, но так ярко и так легко, и столько любви в нем. То есть он походя успевает кого-то спасти, выпутаться из какой-то передряги, и в то же время невероятно любит своих детей. И они в нем как-то так очень точно отражаются. И поэтому, конечно, для меня он... Ну, просто волшебный человек, в принципе, и когда он дал свое согласие, я был в восторге.
Well, Dima is really an unbelievable finding for me. To be honest, I'm sort of in love with him in a good way. He's the character I can relate the most myself. He's so astonishing. He lives day by day, but so brightly. He manages sort of on the go to help someone out, to get into trouble, to get an adventure, and his relationship with his children and how they are mirroring him and his personality from within them is absolutely wonderful. I think he's just a wonderful guy, and when he agreed to participate in the film, it was really a really happy moment for me.
И была при нашем практически первом знакомстве, он рассказал историю, в которую я сразу же поверил, потому что, ну, бывают люди, которым веришь сразу, без какой-то дополнительной верификации. Так вот, когда он еще служил в армии, у него был отгул, и он в тундре ловил рыбу для всей своей части этой армейской, и случайно наткнулся на заблудившихся именно немецких туристов, которых он не только вывел, но и привел в часть, накормил, потом на служебной машине посадил на поезд. Вот. Но, как вы понимаете, когда об этом узнали, его начальство узнало об этом, Дима чудом избежал наказания за государственную измену. Вот. Как бы это страшно ни звучало. Теперь уже смешно, но тогда было страшно. И, конечно, когда мы увидели на дороге этих ребят на мотоцикле, во-первых, было сразу понятно, что они туристы, но я думаю, как любому немцу понятно, по как бы внешнему виду еще даже не разговариваешь, что это там ребята из Восточной Европы, из России, Украины, неважно. Точно так же и здесь было совершенно очевидно, что они иностранцы. И когда мы остановились, они оказались немцами, мы решили, что это просто знак судьбы. И эта сцена не могла не родиться. Вот.
Dima told me a story at the very beginning of our acquaintance, and you know, he's one of these people who you just believe them from the very first time. And he told me this story when he used to serve in the army, and he had a day off, and he went to the tundra to fish. And he was fishing to get fish for the whole crew back at the base. And he stumbled upon a group of German tourists who were lost in the forest or in the tundra. So not only he rescued them, he brought them to the military base, fed them, drove them on his on the car of the military car to the train station and made sure they safely found their way. Later on, when the administration of the military camp found out about this, he barely got out of the criminal charge for treason. Now it's a funny story, but back then it must have been pretty dramatic. So when we were filming and we saw these guys on the motorcycles, it was immediately obvious that they were tourists. I'm sure German people would also immediately spot a Eastern European, Ukrainian, or Russian. So it was obvious they were foreigners. And when we found out that they were Germans, we thought, this is really a fate.
It has to be the scene in the film.
Yeah, great story. So maybe one little last question. In our preparations to our talk, you said that you are right now shooting your next movie. Maybe you can tell us shortly what it will be about. And maybe you can also tell what it means to shoot a movie in Corona times.
На самом деле, к сожалению, к счастью для нашего с вами разговора, но, к сожалению, для меня съемки у нас как раз благодаря новым ограничениям перенеслись, пока мы не знаем, когда они продолжатся или возобновятся. Что касается этой истории, то я бы пока не хотел вдаваться в подробности, могу лишь сказать, что то, что меня сейчас волнует, то, что я пишу и пытаюсь снимать, связано с темой взросления. А что из этого выйдет? Посмотрим.
Unfortunately, for me, well, fortunately for our conversation today, but unfortunately for me, the shooting of my film is postponed. I don't know exactly when it will be restarted because of all the restrictions. I wouldn't want to go too much into the detail of the subject matter, but the only thing I'd like to share is that what I'm focused on right now is the coming of age. And I don't know what's going to come out of it, but this is the theme that is really captivating me now, and that's what I'm working on.
Okay, thank you a lot that you have, fortunately for us, the time for this conversation. And to our audience, I just want to say that you can watch Froth and all our other competition films on X-Ground On Demand. And don't forget to vote for our audience award. And thank you, Victoria and Ilya, for this wonderful conversation. And hope to see you soon in real life somewhere.